My name is Melanie, and I'm a Cree woman from Mispawistic Cree Nation, or Grand Rapids, Manitoba, and I'm a nurse for almost 17 years, and I had the privilege of helping to look after my grandfather during his end-of-life phase. A few years after I started my nursing practice, my grandfather became terminally ill with a rare form of cancer in his sinuses. And it was probably diagnosed in early August. And then he passed by the following January, so certainly less than 6 months. And he wanted to die at home. And we weren't quite sure as a family how we were going to make that happen. But we knew we wanted to honor his wishes. And we have a very large family. My grandparents had 10 children and helped raise many of their grandchildren, including myself, for a little while. And so the extended family was certainly, we certainly had the capacity and the numbers to be able to support his last few wishes. When he began to deteriorate, he actually deteriorated pretty quickly. But that length of time was actually almost to the day, 2 weeks. I don't know if it was cultural or because he was always so independent, but he did have a hard time with allowing us, his daughters and his granddaughters, to look after him and to provide, you know, self-care. His sons actually did it in the beginning. He seemed to be, you know, more comfortable with that until the last few days, where it was you know, too much for anybody else that didn't have some form of healthcare training to be able to support him in that way. So then he allowed us to look after him. When I think back to, you know, being a nurse now for almost 17 years and training, you know, starting more than just 20 years ago, the idea of the palliative care rotation was the scariest for most of us. We weren't comfortable with palliative care or with terminal illness. And when we did have a patient that came home, we didn't always do a great job. The supports weren't really there, certainly from a community perspective. Most communities are, you know, were less than 1,000 people. They had maybe a nursing station or a small health center. And so we were trained, you know, in public health and community health, some primary care, but very little palliative care. So it certainly wasn't a subject matter that we were comfortable with or knew enough about to do that well. So we shied away from it. But there was one thing that happened that I will never forget in that experience. And I had a young gentleman, a father of two grown children, but he was in his late 40s, and he was dying of throat cancer. I remember walking into his room, and he was lying in bed, and because he was so dehydrated, he was sleeping, but his eyes were open and somewhat rolled back. And it was really scary looking, and he was scary looking for the family. And I just got some saline and wet some gauze and dampened his eyes and closed them. And his daughter grabbed my hand and she said, "Thank you." And I didn't really appreciate at the time what that meant, that little gesture of caring and dignity. And how the family as well was so afraid of the bigger picture of death, but he looked like he was dying, literally dying right in front of him, which he was, but it could have looked a little bit more comfortable. So I knew how to make my grandfather comfortable, and I knew how to make him look good and to feel good and refreshed to the best that we could. And because he was my grandfather, I knew how to love him. And at the end of the day, you know, that's what it was really about, and how to show how much you love somebody. If we can get to a point in our communities, if you think of wellness along the continuum, and end of life is still, there's still a lot of elements of wellness, and emotional wellness is one of them if you're prepared, you know, for that stage or that time in life. But we have to do that for more than just the patient and First Nation communities. We also have to do that with our families and our community members, because death has been taken out of our communities, or peaceful and natural death has been taken out of our communities, that it's fairly difficult for us to know what that looks like, or how to behave, or how to act, or how to support. And most of the death that we've experienced has been traumatic. So the idea of palliation or palliative care in our communities is almost a new one, but yet as old as time immemorial, because we've been here for, what some would even say, you know, more than 500,000 years. So, but it's been the last 50 years where we've medicalized birth and wellness and health of, you know, the average adult, and then medicalized dying and taken out of our communities. So the idea of bringing that back in needs to come with additional supports and training or understanding, or the reintroduction of traditional philosophies, so that our elders can die with dignity and be cared for by those that love them most in their home, as comfortable as possible. There were certainly some challenges with some of his my grandfather's clinical care and comfort measures. We were able to get, you know, a hospital bed, other supplies that we would need, and different equipment that we would need. It did take a while, and it required some pre-planning and on our part, and with the help of home care and the clinic nurses. It was really difficult with respect to physician care and pain control, because they had visiting physicians. And at that time, sometimes the physician would just be there for like 2 days, once a month. And when you're not sure what, how the disease is going to progress, how slowly or how quickly, it's difficult to plan. And there was no issue with the physician prescribing pain control in the beginning, but there became an issue in the appropriate type of pain control near the end. Even if a prescription was written, it would still take 3 to 5 days to get there. And my grandfather didn't complain of a lot of pain until the very end. But the very end, you know, was literally 24 to 48 hours. So there was just no time to have the appropriate type of pain control for him. So that would be certainly something that I think that we should all be, you know, cognizant of in providing palliative care or comfort measures in rural, remote, or northern communities. It was probably the most remarkable thing we've ever done as a family, and not something that we want to do again, but we know we're going to one day. My grandmother is still with us, and that's certainly a promise that we've made, you know, to her as well. If we have the privilege to be able to plan for that, and that was a privilege that was afforded with my grandfather, even though it was about his death and his dying and his passing, we were able to plan and to prepare and to be present, and allow him to be present in his capacity and his faculties right to the end.